Have you heard the news? It's getting lots of rave reviews. A good time is waiting just for you at Sister Spokesman. Girl, won't you send a fax? Drop on by, grab a drink and relax. Bring your business cards and we'll chat at Sister Spokesman.
Hey sisters. All right. Hey sisters. Okay, now let me see a hand of who's here for the first time. All right, so we got rules of engagement. Here's how it goes. When I say hey sisters, you say and the purpose in that is because I know we're all here for different reasons and different causes and we all want to have fun today. But we also want to make sure that anybody's on the mic, we hear them. So you might have came to just see me, and I get that. But the person next to you might want to actually hear what the panel's saying. So make sure they're able to do that, okay? So let's just give everybody a little respect. So when I say, hey, sister, that's because we're too loud. So I want everybody to get ready. So let's start the day off because it's time for you to be introduced to this powerful panel. These are the women that are empowering us this afternoon at our women empowerment discussion. So what we're going to do is I'm going to introduce them all, and then they're going to say a little bit about themselves, and then I'm going to open it up. Well, I'll ask a few questions to start us off, then we're going to open it up. I'm going to ask everyone, because we are televising today, please do not tell your personal story. When I come around, ask a question. If you want to tell a story, I'm going to walk away from you. Don't be mad, but I'm not here for that today, okay? So don't tell personal stories, ask questions, okay? Are we all good with that?
Yeah.
Okay, so I think we're ready to get ready. So with no further ado, I would like to start off by introducing a very dear friend of mine, Dr. Reatha Clark-King, otherwise known as my other mother. Yes, Dr. King is a scientist, educator, and a tireless volunteer, and is currently on corporate governance board, so she stays extremely busy, even though she's retired. She has a BS, Bachelor's of Science degree in chemistry and math, and a MS, Master's degree, and a PhD, doctorate in philosophy, degree in physical chemistry, and an MBA, Master's of Business Administration degree. She is a former president, General Mills Foundation, and Metro State University. She also serves on the board of directors of dozens of companies and nonprofits, locally and nationally. Dr. King is a recipient of numerous awards, including 14 honorary doctorate degrees. Dr. King is the wife of deceased Dr. Judge King and the mother of two. Let's welcome Dr. Reatha Clark.
Thank you very much, Tracy, for that wonderful, wonderful introduction. I would say that was a robust introduction, and I appreciate every word you said. However, you left out the truly most important part. I'm the grandmother of three, ages 13, 17, and 18 years old, but truly the mother of two wonderful, wonderful sons. And I was a spouse for 52 and a half years of my dear husband, Judge King, whom so many of you knew. I want to say how honored I am to be able to participate today on this panel with two young sisters. And I suppose Tracy decided to start with an elder. Introducing me, and I'm honored that you did, because I'm gracious for all 77 years of life that I've lived so far. And I also am grateful to be participating in this program again, this panel. I'm a native of South Georgia. Born and raised in Moultrie, Georgia, went from there to Clark College, then Clark College, and born in 1938, so that tells a story within itself, as most of you will know. Overcoming the obstacles put before us because of gender and race. So that tells a story in itself. I have lived a blessed life with many accomplishments, but I'm not realizing that accomplishments are to enable you to serve. So everything Tracy said about my background simply says that I have benefited from a lot of enabling tools for service. So the question now is, how will I use those? I have flunked retirement. I can tell you that outright. People see me and say, aren't you retired? Well, I have to fess up that I keep flunking retirement, and that's a good thing. So I'll stop there and turn the podium to my fellow panelists and give the mic back to Tracy. Oh. Well, the cat is out of the bag. I'm a Delta. Somebody yell from the audience.
Okay, so let's continue on to our next distinguished panelist, and that's Nekima Levy Pounds, another dear friend of mine. Nekima, yes. Nekima received her BA from the University of Southern California and her Juris Doctor from the University of Illinois College of Law. Nekima is an American lawyer, professor, activist, writer, and preacher. She was elected in 2015 to be the president of the Minnesota chapter of the NAACP, and also serves on and has founded a variety of organizations that focus on issues of racial equality and disparity in the Minnesota, Minneapolis, and St. Paul areas. She is an associate professor of law at the University of St. Thomas in Minneapolis, where she began teaching in 2003. She writes and serves local publications, including the Star Tribune, Men Post, and the Minnesota Spokesman Recorder. And she has been recognized for her legal work, including being named 2015 Attorney of the Year by Minnesota Lawyer. Nekima is a wife and mother of five. Let's give her a round of applause.
Hi, everyone. Happy New Year to you all. It's wonderful to look out and see so many beautiful black women in the audience. We have a lot of power, even though society often tries to downplay the power of black women. We have seen so many examples throughout our history, and I'm honored to be able to stand on the shoulders of the giants who have come before us. Like Dr. Reatha Clark-King, like Tracy Dillard of the Spokesman, and so many others out there who played a pivotal role and standing for freedom, justice, and equality for our community. I moved here in 2003 when the law school was just 2 years old at St. Thomas. I liked the idea of being able to get in on the ground floor and to help shape the direction of the institution. I also love being a part of this community. It's a challenge at times when we look at the racial disparities that we face. However, it's a vibrant, robust community where there's actually a lot of opportunity. But I have come to realize that we have to fight for what we want. And that's the philosophy that I live by, just being willing to fight, being willing to speak truth to power, and to stand for freedom, justice, and equality.
All right. And last but certainly not least, we got our young activists in the room with us. Asha Long, and Asha is one of the Black Lives Matters organizers. All right. She's with Minnesota Public Interest Research Group, campus organizer. She attended Augsburg College and McAllister College, and she was there as a campus organizer as well. Black Lives Matter is an international activist movement organizing an African American community that against violence towards black people. MPIRG is a grassroots, nonpartisan, nonprofit, student-directed organization that empowers and trains students and engages the community to take collective action in the public interest throughout the state of Minnesota. She has a BA in Liberal Arts, General Studies, and Humanity, 2009 through 2013 from St. Paul Scholastic in Duluth. Let's hear from our sister, Asha.
Hey, sisters. I love that so much, y'all. Again, I'm Asha Long. I'm born and raised in Minneapolis. I went to Harvest Prep, all-black school. I went to De La Salle, and then I went up to Duluth to get my bachelor's at St. Scholastica, and we know how Duluth is for black people up there. So that ignited my passion, and I came home, and I'm actively working to change things here in my home, in my community for black people. I'm young, I have a lot to learn, and I'm here to absorb from my community and from my elders. And the question returns, as the doctor said, what tools do I have and how do I use them in service of my community? So I'm always learning and growing, and I thank you guys for having me here.
And we thank all three of you ladies for being here with us this afternoon. We're gonna get right into it and get started with the questions. You can all answer one answer. It doesn't matter how we do it. Let's start off with how do you inspire and encourage women?
I'm happy to start answering that, and just very briefly, I would say I inspire women. I try to inspire and encourage women by giving them confidence. I meet so many women who, just like me, as I was many years ago, who don't see the beauty, the skills, the talents that they have, and have the confidence, and I wanna underscore the need for confidence, to just use them. So that's what empowerment means to me, empowerment. How do I help to empower other women? What do they need? Encouragement? Money, or just what do they need to feel empowered? When you feel empowered, you will do a lot of good things, and you don't go about feeling sorry for yourself, right?
I would say how I inspire and encourage women is typically to think about someone throughout our history who has lived a life of strong leadership and going against the odds. So one of the folks who has inspired me throughout history is Harriet Tubman. I mean, Harriet Tubman was a strong woman in a situation in which black people really didn't have a voice in society. They were enslaved. They didn't have Instagram, Twitter, Facebook, didn't even have vehicles. And yet Harriet Tubman not only freed herself from slavery, but she went back 19 times and freed 300 other people. And she also said, I would have freed more if only they knew they were slaves. So I take great inspiration from Harriet Tubman's example. And I say, you know, if she could do it, then what's stopping the rest of us when we see problems and challenges in society? She was a woman who did what she had to do in spite of what was probably fear, because there was a bounty on her head. They were out to kill Harriet Tubman and to try to stop her and other abolitionists from setting the captives free, yet she did it anyway. So I just want to encourage women to go against the grain and not just accept the positions that society tries to place us in. Society always has tried to box women in. And it's up to us to not only reject that notion that we have to live in a box, but we have to pick up the box and reshape it into what it needs to be. And I think every woman has the capacity to do that.
For me, I seek inspiration in women. I feel like I'm inspired by many women, and you can see the light that especially black women have. When I'm in community with black women, when I'm sharing space with black women, it's incredibly powerful. And just relating on a sister-to-sister basis, that's a connection like no other connection in the world when you're with another Black woman sharing space and sharing your experiences. And for me, I feel that we co-inspire each other by squashing all the crap in the world, and just holding each other and being a safe space for each other. Because only when we're allowed to be vulnerable and really be in community with each other can we build, and can we create goals together and achieve that together. So I'm not sure if I inspire women, but I'm inspired by my connection with women, and we inspire each other.
Okay, Asha, you got the mic. Why don't you keep it for a minute? Asha, I want to ask you the next question, and then we can come back down this way with the mic. If you could change one thing in the world right now, what would that be?
If I could change one thing in the world, I know this. Okay, I would like to turn patriarchy, you know, we're in a patriarchal society dominated by men. I would like to see what that looks like as a matriarchal society. What would the world look like if women were in power, especially Black women? Like, the systems, the institutions, the laws, everything would change. And I think it would be the most powerful society for all people, not just Black people. So I think that would be beautiful.
That's an excellent question. I would say I would like to shift the transfer of wealth in our society, specifically towards people of color, and especially African Americans, because this country was built off of the backs of our ancestors. We have never been compensated for what our ancestors have gone through, and we continue to pay the price of inequitable treatment in this country. And we know that there is a transfer of wealth that goes on from one generation to the next in many white families and communities. And it's time for us to be able to tap into that transfer of wealth. Wealth, land, corporations, and reparations for what our people have gone through.
I think I'm going to change the tone just a little bit because I'm yearning for one thing today, more than anything else, and that is for respect, for people to be able to respect each other. With racial tolerance, gender tolerance, wealth gap, getting across the wealth gap, economic gap, education gaps. I'm looking for the kind of society where people respect each other and stop attacking each other and putting each other down. And automatically, that's a source of wealth for our economy, because people are able to contribute, everyone, and then to make lives better for all of us. I have been in situations through the years where our own people will attack and make fun of you because they say you're educated. You got a lot of amens in churches when you see those kinds of attacks. Well, why is that? That's brutal. That's hurtful. But can't we lift each other up? I'm looking for a society where we can lift all up and therefore empower, and so that the pie grows bigger for everybody. That is a wish that I have, that I long for, and I just would like to put that on the table. We have put forth a lot of tools to deal with the problems through the years, but one of the difficulties is that we think we have it solved, and then we stop applying the tools. Once you get the perfect solutions, you gotta maintain the situation. Our neighborhoods go back to being bad if we don't maintain them and keep them safe. So we need people to come together across cultures, across races, across gender, and work together and show commitment to keeping problems solved.
Okay. So Dr. Reatha Clark-King, let me ask you the next question to start us off. What are the some of the obstacles you encountered as a woman in power, and how did you overcome them?
Well, I want to. I thought about that woman in power. What does that mean? That I'm translating that to mean that you had access to influential positions that enable you where you could make a difference, right? That's what being in a powerful position, I think I interpreted to mean. One obstacle that you're going to encounter over and over, not to discourage my younger sisters here, is racial and gender discrimination.
Right.
In somebody's eyes, those problems and hindrances are not solved forever. You might solve them in your neighborhood because people have gotten to know you, but when you step out of your neighborhood and meet someone else who has not had experience with black people, you gotta help them learn too. So you're going to encounter those problems over and over. But what I did to overcome, to deal with them, or to mitigate them, as we call, is I always, from the early years, I remember 4 years old in South Georgia, in my segregated community, sought to prepare myself. I have been studious to a fault, and I constantly prepare myself. I keep on learning. So I'm prepared for the next obstacle, even though I don't know what it's going to be, right? I keep on preparing myself. I want to do constant homework because I know when I go in to chair my meeting, the board of the National Association for Corporate Directors, they're depending on me for leadership. And for me to be able to help figure out the problems on the table or lead the group to figuring out the problem. So I'm preparing myself for that moment. What's around the corner? All kinds of situations to build confidence. I work on that every day, building confidence. I've learned to forget about that lipstick and those eyeglasses and whether they're the right color, all of those little things that get you all stressed up before a television camera. The camera is going to do its job whether you write or not. So you learn to de-stress so you can better perform when difficulties, surprises happen. And certainly, I stay close to church, close to my church. Barbara Cassius and I in Sunday school every Sunday morning, and we're in church together. We go to the 7:45 service. We're there every Sunday morning, and from a little girl, I always stay close to church. And my family, supporting my family and community. I give time that I don't have, I didn't think I have, to community service. Not for show, not before a television camera, not to get an article in the newspaper, but just the little things that will make things better. And I don't need the glory. I want to emphasize that. But we were taught service to help community in 1940 in South Georgia. That's the way we made it. That's the way we survived. So that habit stays with me, and I get great joy from it. So now, the people at the White House in Washington, D.C., and the fancy buildings there, and my powerful friends there, they don't know how important this is for me to keep nurturing and making myself stronger. This morning at my computer, I was pedaling like mad, raising money for the Morehouse College Glee Club when they come here for Black History Month. And I had my strategy all laid out. And we want to make that event successful, and we hope many of you will come. But we're going to have those 45 black men singers, and they have put together a choir of 225 high school young people to sing on that big stage with them. And we want, now, I thought of another hitch this morning. I said, we got to take care of that. We want the parents of those high school students to be able to come too. And they're not accustomed to paying $30 and $40 for a ticket. So for our community committee, I got to take back that. I say, hey, heck, you guys, we need a contingency fund here for something else because we want the parents to be able to come. But that's my cause. This month, in March, it will be something else. But you don't need the television cameras to help your community and for us to inspire these young people.
Thank you, and I want to just add something to that, just to say that when you look at Dr. King here, a lot of us, you know, we can't wait to retirement. We can't wait to do nothing. And a lot of us aren't doing nothing now that we could be. So when we talk about women empowerment, she is a prime example. I mean, you do things just because you know it's the right thing to do. And how much energy would it take to sit in front of a computer and to really reach out to people and try to help raise money, try to help a cause that you believe in? So it's just these things that help you to empower yourself. You don't have to wait to get paid to do it. She's not getting paid to do that. She's helping an organization that she believes in, and she's reaching out. So when we talk about women empowerment, this is just one way of many that you can empower yourself. So tell us now, Nekima, what are some of the obstacles you encounter every day still? And I can probably answer half of them for you. As a woman in power, and how did or do you overcome them?
So yes, Tracy, I have encountered many obstacles on this path, and it really is my faith and belief in God that helps me overcome those obstacles, because some days all I can do is call on Jesus to be able to persevere, because there are a lot of spiritual attacks that come with this work. And I have to be fortified. I have to be prayed up. I have to have people around me who can see the vision, understand that, and help pray us through whatever obstacles we have to overcome. But I know that at the end of the day, failure is not an option. And giving up is not an option either. That's something that I've learned as a woman through it all. I would say that the other obstacles that I've had to overcome that I think many Black women face is the fact that so often we're taught to wear a badge of inferiority in society. That was something that I dealt with my first couple of years on the job, where I felt inferior because I started teaching law. I think I was about 26 years old, and I was, you know, the only African American woman on the faculty. Most of my colleagues were over 40 and they were white men. And it took me a long time to develop a strong sense of identity and purpose, and to understand that I didn't have to always ask permission to do what I needed to do. That was a mistake that I made my first couple of years. I would ask permission to do something different or bring forward a new idea. And typically, because people are used to doing things a certain way, they say no, even if it is a good idea. And I realized that I really wasn't getting anywhere in terms of being able to fight for my community or bring forward new ways of doing things by constantly asking permission. So I just started doing it. And then apologizing later. I didn't realize X, Y, or Z. But by then, I mean, I'm already 10 steps ahead. Because I just said, you know what, I have to keep pushing the envelope and thinking outside the box and trying innovative ways of doing things. And I also paid attention to my students. I mean, I'm a person who, although I'm in the classroom teaching, I learn just as much from those around me. So when my students are coming forward with new ideas, showing me how to use technology, giving me insights, I take all of that in and try to incorporate that into what I do. That's played a huge role in being able to do things differently. I also had to get to the point where I realized that I'm God's daughter. I think, you know, so often in society, we are made to feel, as I was saying earlier, as though we're inferior. because Black women are not lifted up in society. There's often negative images of who we are. We know that those are false images. We know that we are beautiful, that we are strong, that we are resilient, that as Tupac said, we have to make a dollar out of 15 cents. That's the legacy of Black women. I mean, when during slavery, they gave us scraps to work with and we made meals that have sustained our community from one generation to the next. And so I had to realize it was God who has empowered the women before me, and it's because he cares about us and we're made in his image. We have attributes that God has placed on the inside of us that make each of us unique. And once I came to that realization, I said, I'm not going to stay limited to what society says that I am, because society will always undermine my potential. And once I got to that place where I said, wait a minute, I walk into a room, I'm like, oh, I'm God's daughter. That changed everything. When I would walk into a room, I'm like, I'm not inferior to these people, I'm his daughter. And I feel that that's one of the highest positions that we can attain as Black women in this society, recognizing we're made in his image and that our power and our potential is unlimited if we're willing to trust him.
My biggest obstacle that I faced, I could list a lot of them. We all face the same issues as Black women because we are powerful, because we are holy. We will always face those obstacles. But the big one for me, as both of these ladies had stated, is myself. I am my biggest obstacle. My professor in college told me, you know, you are the monster that's growling underneath your bed. You are what you fear and you are your hero. And you know, as we've done these protests over the last year, and as I'm sure some of you have been out there taking those streets, taking back what's yours and owning it, and making your voice loud and heard, you understand that these systems are nothing more than a war in the mind. I am because I think I am, and I am because I believe and know that I am. And just as Nekima stated, they don't want us to tap into all of that power, tap into that wholeness that Black womanhood brings to our lives. When I'm battling myself, because I get scared and I get worried and I get anxious, I lean on God first because that is my pillar. And then I lean on my mama and my grandmama because they are everything to me. And then I lean on my mentors and my elders to give me words that I need to hear when I need to hear them. So for me, and all of that, and the end result is I'm using my tools to help my community, but it is not about me. It is about my community, and I am a vessel. And that is what I continuously, you know, pump through myself, and I'm praying to, and that's what I receive from God. And I feel like, you know, I Audre Lorde, you know, has a quote, you know, when I use my, you know, tools in the service of others, it doesn't matter whether I'm afraid or not. And it's not about me. And praying on that and keeping close to God and my mentors and my elders and my family, what is an obstacle? I have no obstacles.
Okay, Dr. King wants to say one more word, then I'm going to open it up to the audience, so if you have questions, I'll come around.
What I like to say is a word of encouragement to all of us, and I thank my fellow panelists here for reminding me to say this. Through the years, over the last 70 years of my life, I've come to realize that we have to be proud of our Blackness.
Yes.
And not self-conscious about our Blackness. Now, I can say this now, having worked in so many predominantly white, all white situations, or all Asian situations, or all Latino situations, where I'm the only African American there. And then when I travel to other African countries, I'm the African American because they are African and mixed with something. But I think overcoming our self-consciousness about our being Black. It's a good kind of freedom to feel. And if anybody then tries to make you self-conscious about, tries to spotlight your Blackness, you can, with confidence, turn and say, that's your problem, not mine. So you don't want people to make your Blackness a problem for you, because it is clear they're trying to do that, says that your Blackness is a problem for them, not you. But so I can't underscore that point. We got to be proud of our Blackness. Proud of our Blackness. So if we take one thing from these Sister Spokesman forums, I would encourage us to let that be the case. And so now when you act proud of your Blackness, somebody might accuse you of being arrogant, right? You know, that's another way to make you feel guilty. But just disregard that. Be proud of your Blackness.
Okay, we're gonna open it up for our first question. Please stand, tell your name.
My name is LaDonna. So it's kind of a comment more than anything else. Like, I'm amazed with Black Lives Matter. The thing that kind of disturbs me overall is the unconsciousness of us as African Americans. It seems like there has to be some sort of dramatic type of event where thousands or lots of Black lives are being lost at the hand of other races for us to wake up. My thing is, and this goes back to what you said, Ms. King, is what and why are we not, and how do we get a sense of community? I did a Google search recently of places, worst places for African Americans to live, and it's here. Minnesota is number one. Illinois, Iowa, Wisconsin. You know, there's no sense of community for African Americans. So for ones that are consciously awake, how do we awaken others? How do we keep that sense of community with ourselves?
Another part of how we empower ourselves. Who wants to answer that?
How do we stay in community with each other? As a woke person, I feel you, because you're aware to what's going on. You really just have to be with people. Like, you just have to be in community with people in a genuine way. And I know for me sometimes it's hard, because being awake it's very frustrating, because people can't see what you see, and it is isolating. But what's important is that we recognize that is not the humanity of the person. Like, they need to be unlocked, and you're there to help kind of smooth over the lock. Do you know what I mean? You're there to just be there with them. And just like I said, when I feel inspired by women, I love to just sit and talk to people. You hear exactly where they're at when you sit and talk to people. And then you can, by being that sister, you know, that brother that you need in their lives, you can start to put seeds in their mind. And they may not fruit tomorrow, they may not bloom tomorrow, but you've planted a seed that is going to affect great change. It's gonna take root, because each person is so, you know, there's so much fertility, there's so much potential in all of those people. And, you know, doing, that's the work, igniting that light. And of course they don't want that light burning, because we're gonna burn all this shit down.
Since what you're saying, in Minnesota, we are a dispersed community. African Americans, for the most part, we have a concentration in a few neighborhoods, but we are more dispersed than, say, in Atlanta, in Chicago, certain communities there, and in some other cities, even New York City, we are dispersed. So I have found, and I would encourage, that we create a sense of community, first of all, by participating. Now, the first one I would say is getting to the polls and voting. if you're eligible to vote, and so many people are not, get out and participate that way. Whether it's a big election or a small election, get out to vote if you are eligible. That helps to empower our communities when they participate like that as a group. In my building, downtown Minneapolis, we have a reputation for being, that address, 110 Bank Street, is one of the biggest participants. We have the highest level of participation on election day than any other address in the building. And it's because people are civic-minded. So let's be civic-minded. If we don't get out and use the influence we have, it's going to be difficult for us to get recognized as a group. Then, again, respecting each other. We have a lot of economic segregation ourselves amongst our people, our own people. And there's no need for that, you know. We should respect each other regardless of the level of the economy we are functioning at. So I think our faith community can pull people together there, pull us together, but we tend to segregate from those who have less ourselves. And that's better than it used to be. When I was in college, we had color segregation amongst blacks. Fair-skinned people were considered to be better than black-skinned people. So we have improved on the internal segregation amongst blacks, but we have some ways to go. So we can work on that ourselves. Economic celebration segregation is one bigger problem. And I won't start on the schools. We know the gaps there, education gaps, and what's happened to low-income families. And that was referenced in that polling ranking of Minnesota as being one of the worst states in the country along those gaps. So I think the good thing about the Black Lives Matter movement is giving voice to these issues and to the problem between the police and what appears to be some targeting of black men. But we've had the voice in other years. When I was growing up, we had other sources of voice. SNCC was a voice, a powerful voice on different things. We had the Southern Christian Leadership Conference. That was a voice. We've had the NAACP is a very strong voice. But the rest of us have to do our part and follow through. And know that each individual can do something. So that's the way we're going to bring the black community together. And by all means, let's use the spot where we are, at our desk, at our computers. Let's do what we can do individually. We can't just rely on the NAACP or Black Lives Matter. We got to do what we can individually.
Before I ask the next question, I need to ask whoever's driving a black Chevrolet, that's parked on this side of the building, you're blocking someone in, I need to ask you to move your car immediately before it gets towed.
Hi, my name is Twaya McIntosh, and first of all, I want to say I am so happy to be here with so many beautiful, beautiful, beautiful women. I was born and raised here in Minneapolis, Minnesota, and one thing my brother had told me at a very, very early age is to support black-owned, and I want to think that I have followed that, and I still am. But anyway, the thing that's bothering me right now is what is not so much the answer, but am I the only one that notices that our young brothers and sisters are not getting past seventh, eighth grade. I'm not seeing the graduation rates. I don't see the college of our young children, of our kids. What is your take on that, Dr. King and Nevy and, you know, Ashley? Why is there so few of us on these bus stops? And when you go in the schools, the public schools, not so much alternative.
For me, the answer to that would, you'd have to look towards the prison industrial complex and how they're funneling our children into the system at very young ages. We have to look at the institutionalization of our schools. They look more like prisons than they do schoolyards. The system is doing exactly what it's designed to do, and it's getting our kids before they even get a chance to get college educated, before they get a chance to get high school diplomas, and we have to nip it in the bud. Like, that's my really only thing that we can point to, because the state is failing our kids. We don't have any curriculum that looks like us, so how are they supposed to be engaged? How are they supposed to engage with authority figures that don't have their best interest in mind, that are looking for tenure in urban schools, trying to get debt erased? They don't care about our kids, and we have to actively combat that and or create alternative solutions to that.
Okay.
I would just respond to that by saying I think the root of a lot of these issues is white supremacy. That's something that Professor Mahmoud El-Qadi talks about a lot. And often we're afraid to say the words white supremacy. So I want to hear y'all say white supremacy. We have to begin to get that in our vocabulary and not be ashamed to call it what it is. Because it is at the root of a lot of the problems we have. A lot of the institutions that have been created for our demise. We don't run these systems. We didn't create these systems, but we're constantly seeing the impacts on our community. And we have to fight back. Going back to the earlier question about creating a sense of community, I think number one, we have to be intentional about creating that sense of community. It doesn't mean that everyone has to get along all the time or there has to be some false united front. I typically reject that. I'm typically looking for people who are serious about uplifting and building the community. And riding with them and encouraging them to run this next leg of the race, because I feel that we've entered into phase two of the civil rights movement. I believe that Black Lives Matter has helped to bring that to the forefront, because all of these issues that we're talking about, whether it's the system of mass incarceration or disparities in public education or high poverty rates, the juvenile justice system, I mean, the list goes on and on. All of these are issues that we have had to deal with since our ancestors were brought here forcibly to this country. And rather than things getting better, they have gotten worse. And sometimes the problems hide under the facade of a few of us being able to reach the top. And they're used as poster children. If they're able to get a bachelor's or some other higher degree and make six figures, we see them as poster children, when in reality, the system is designed for only a few to rise to the top. So we need to be intentional about the future that we want to create, and we need to decide that we're willing to fight back. That's what I admire so much about the young people now and during the 1960s. They refuse to be refused. They're willing to use their bodies as a living sacrifice. They're willing to reject this false notion of the American dream and fight for what they believe in. But it's too many of us sitting on the sidelines waiting for somebody else to do what we all need to do. There's enough power in this room, enough talent, enough creativity, strong voices, and resources to change the status quo, because the status quo is killing our people and it's killing our community. So we need to decide that 2016 is going to be different. That we didn't just show up at a Sister Spokesman event, eat some good food, drink some good drinks, hear some good speakers, but seeds are being deposited that we are going to bring forward into something good on behalf of our community. And that means everybody has to roll up their sleeves and get involved. Everybody has a role to play. You don't have to go lie down on train tracks if that's not what you're interested in.
That's what I happen to do with Asha and other people if it comes down to it. You may not even want to go to City Hall. That's what Asha and I may do if it comes down to it. Sometimes maybe it's going to talk to the governor. But other times, it's going into your places of worship. It's going into your workplaces. It's going into your neighborhoods and saying enough is enough. We are going to demand the changes that we want to see. And as women, we can do that.
Okay. So now, I have to, this is the part I hate the most. Because we just get started, and it's already time for me to end this segment, Sister Spokesman. I'm sorry. I got another demonstration that's coming up next. We got vendors in the room. We got a short period of time left this afternoon together, so we got to move the program on. So, Nekima wrapped it up very well, because I was going to ask the question, what advice would you leave these women? You did an excellent job at articulating your thoughts on what you want to leave with them. Can I get the other two panelists to leave with them what advice you're going to send them home with this afternoon on how they can be empowered?
I would just say get involved and decide, like we've been encouraged to decide what we are going to do. It might not be the same as what somebody else prefers to do, but do something. And also realize that getting involved is, you find that is empowering itself. That gives you encouragement, inspiration to do something else, because we need some creativity. And the creativity comes from one kind of success, where you get ideas and you go on to do something else. Just sitting here thinking of my project to get those 225 young men on that stage, I thought, I first said, their parents, well, we need to provide tickets for their parents. Then I thought, well, we need to offer help with the young people for their clothes, right? And what else do we need to do? So ideas come to you of new things you can do. And if you want to get involved with the prison system and get some of the people who are former felons out entitled to vote again, they've lost their voting privilege. That was my husband's number one project, to help former prisoners get their voting privileges back. That's something I could work on. So decide to do something, and by all means, take care of our own children, and try to show them that it's worth studying, it's worth getting education. That was the number one factor that helped me growing up in South Georgia. The community people took my illiterate parents and us children under their wings and said, child, it's worth getting an education. Get an education, get an education. They need that encouragement. They need to be inspired not to give up. We can do that, the rest of us.
I would remind everyone in this room that you already have the power. I can't empower you because you already have it. These people that are elected think that they have the power, but that's only because you borrowed a piece of your power to them. Claim your power and get in where you fit in, just like these ladies were saying. If you have an idea, you were supposed to have that idea. You were supposed to be the fertile land that that idea grew and blossomed upon the community with. If it wasn't in you, how could you dream it up? So I just want to remind everybody to remember your power and pay attention to how you use your power in your daily life, whether you're buying something from McDonald's or buying something from a black-owned business. Your dollar is your vote in this community or in this capitalistic society. So we need to be thinking more about what we bring to the table and actually supporting ourselves and empowering ourselves and telling ourselves that we can do it and praying about it, because our community needs us in whatever capacity your heart brings to it.
All right. So these ladies are going to be here for just a few minutes after this panel discussion, so you can ask them more questions that you didn't get answered. If you want to find out how to become a member of the Minneapolis NAACP, talk to Nekima. If you want to find out how to be involved with the Black Lives Matter, talk to Asha. Yeah. And if you want to find out how to become a scientist, come talk to Dr. Reatha Clark-King. And if you want to be involved with Sister Spokesman, go talk to my daughter over there at the booth. Let's give them all a round of applause. Thank you so much, ladies, for coming out. Thank you for being on my panel this afternoon. We love you. We look forward to having you come back.
Thank you for having us.
Have you heard the news? It's getting lots of rave reviews. A good time is waiting just for you at Sister Spokesman. Girl, won't you send a fax? Drop on by, grab a drink and relax. Bring your business cards and we'll chat at Sister Spokesman.